Captain Cheesehead
and Mr. Southerton. Hey, boys and girls, what's up? Today we're going to talk about another type of phrase. It's called the appositive, which is actually a single word noun, maybe a pronoun, placed right next to another noun or pronoun, and it acts like an adjective. I know that sounds like an awful lot. It's enough to make a person say, "What the heck is going on out there?" But I think after we see some examples, this is going to be a pretty easy concept for us. It's, again, a noun, maybe a pronoun, placed right next to another noun or pronoun, and it acts like an adjective. And these appositives can have adjectives with them, and they can have prepositional phrases attached to them. And as a whole, they can be called appositive phrases. And these appositive phrases usually show up in the middle, maybe the end, but usually the middle of a sentence, and they're offset by commas, which means a comma will go just before it and sometimes after it, unless, again, it is ending the sentence. So let's take a look at what we have. I want you to read all this information on appositives and appositive phrases and the examples that are shown, and then we're going to start the exercise. Okay, we're back. So now that you read all this material, we're going to go down to the problems. You can see that the instructions say, punctuate the sentences below with commas where needed. Some sentences will be okay without the commas if the added information is essential, like needed. You're going to see this again in some examples, as you may have seen already as you read through the information at the top. In these instructions, we're going to underline the single word that is the appositive, usually a noun or a pronoun, in the appositive phrases. Again, these appositive phrases could have certain things like adjectives and even prepositional phrases attached to them, working as one whole thing. And the appositives and appositive phrases in the sentence will point out, they'll tell something like which one about another noun, usually the subject of the sentence. Again, I know that's a lot of information, but be patient, and let's look at the examples, and I think this is going to be very clear. So a big part of this is the punctuation. Number one, our house is up for sale. You see, I can read the sentence without the appositive if it is, say, non-essential. So I can read the sentence without the appositive or appositive phrase. If I add that extra information in the middle to clarify it and maybe tell which one, then I need to surround it with commas. I need to tell the reader where to pause. Our house is up for sale. Well, which one is it? The brick one. So I need to read it this way. Our house, the brick one, is up for sale. And the word one is actually your appositive. Remember, I'm not saying our house, the brick, is up for sale. Maybe you can imagine yourself pointing to a house. Our house, the one or that one, is up for sale. But again, the word brick in this case is an adjective describing one. But the whole thing, the brick one, is an appositive phrase, which is really describing house. So let's take a look at a couple more. But notice again how we punctuate. It tells the reader where to pause. Our house, the brick one, is up for sale. We're going to continue. Number two, Franco made supper, a pizza with all the toppings. Now some might think, oh, should I put a comma after pizza? But in this case, with all the toppings, is attached to pizza. So I only need the one comma there. Franco made a supper. Let me repeat that. Franco made supper, a pizza with all the toppings. Now, if I had something like this for the whole family, and I could say, Franco made supper for the whole family, if that were my sentence, I can see where we would then want to put a comma after toppings, because we have this added information. But as is, we're just going to say, Franco made supper, a pizza with all the toppings. With all the toppings, that prepositional phrase is part of pizza. So we're not separating it. Let's look at number three. Mr. Orris shot even par for his round. Well, what about Mr. Orris? Oh, he's a pro. A noun, pro. Placed right next to the noun, Mr. Orris. So it's really telling us which one or maybe what kind, like an adjective question, about Mr. Orris. Mr. Orris, what kind of a person is he? The pro. Or which one is he? The pro. Or is he the amateur? He's the pro. Which one? Shot even par for his round. Number four, Mr. Orris shot even par for his round. Maybe I have some adjectives, maybe even a prepositional phrase attached to this noun pro, this appositive pro. So I'd say, Mr. Orris, which one? The inspiring pro at the club shot even par for his round. I put the commas surrounding that appositive phrase, offsetting that appositive phrase to show the reader where to pause. This next situation, as we read up at the top, is essential. For instance, I can't just say, golf pro shot even par for his round. Mr. Orris is part of golf pro. So I'm kind of using that together as one thing. It just sort of rolls right off the tip of my tongue. Golf pro Mr. Orris shot even par for his round. No pause there. It's essential information. I can't just say golf pro shot. I might be able to say the golf pro shot even par, but if I don't have the in front of that, and it's just reading this way, there is no comma. Let's go with number six. We're going to hear about the subject, the noun English, and we're going to clarify that this is a major, but we're going to have a couple of things attached to this appositive. Let's look at it. English can be incredibly boring. Well, I can say English, a major, can be incredibly boring. English, Mr. Southerton's major in college, so I add, for instance, a possessive noun there, I add a prepositional phrase to make this whole thing in a positive phrase, offset by commas, as it shows up right in the middle of the sentence of English can be incredibly boring. By the way, this part, boys and girls, be careful. Just like him, I don't know where that came from. We would never say that is boring. Anyway, let's now go on to number seven. And let's cover this back up. Yeah, that's better. Number seven. I just found my sweater. Well, which one? The one with the red stripes. And I use that comma to offset, well, actually, tell the reader where to pause in this case. Number eight. Our dog guarded our house with authority. What kind of a dog do we have? Adjective question. A German Shepherd, or maybe which one? And again, I could have some other things there. Our dog, a German Shepherd with a big collar, guarded our house with authority. But I put the comma after the noun and subject dog, and another one after the noun and a positive, German Shepherd. It acts, however, like an adjective, even though it's a noun. Number nine. The fine was levied against Mr. Johnson, the owner of the property. Of the property is attached to owner. It's not separate, so I'm not putting a comma there. You have to see how that all reads out. The fine was levied against Mr. Johnson, the owner of the property. Number 10. Here's one of those situations where we have essential information. I'm not saying the baseball player hit 714 home runs. Baseball player is almost part of Babe Ruth's title here. Baseball player Babe Ruth hit 714 home runs during his career. This is essential information to put Babe Ruth in there, so there is no comma. And essential means it's needed. It has to be together. Now, when I say number 11, Babe Ruth, for instance, hit 714 home runs during his career, this information that goes in the middle is not essential. It's just an extra thing clarifying something about Babe Ruth, an extra thing. So that's what we mean by non-essential. It's just thrown in there. Babe Ruth, comma, a great baseball player, comma, hit 714 home runs during his career. The noun player is the appositive, and this noun happens to have a few adjectives attached to it. I'm not saying Babe Ruth was a baseball. Nope. He was a player.
Player.
No. He was a great baseball player. So, I have a comma after Ruth, a comma after player, and that's added information. Moving along, sometimes if we have a lot of adjectives in succession, it can be confusing to the reader if I'm trying to punctuate an appositive phrase with commas when I have so many other commas in the middle of the sentence. So I might use an alternative form of punctuation, like the dash. So look at this. Gazelle Jackson. Gazelle Jackson is cool. That's really what I'm saying. Subject, Gazelle Jackson, is linking verb, predicate adjective, cool. Well, what about Gazelle Jackson? Which one is he? Gazelle Jackson, the kid, is cool. Well, do you have any other information about the kid? This appositive kid? Yeah. He happens to be a scholarly kid. He happens to be studious, super intelligent. He's slick, he's fast, he's smart. He's really smart for that matter. So there's an adverb describing the adjective smart. All that stuff is in there. I even have a prepositional phrase in our history, economics, and math classes. Oh my goodness. But all of that makes up one huge, gigantic, appositive phrase. Kid is the appositive, but the whole appositive phrase is right there. And I want to offset that with dashes in this case. It's not a hyphen. A hyphen is something that's really short, like super intelligent, where I'm combining. The dash sets things off. So it reads one more time like this. Gazelle Jackson, the really smart, fast, slick, super intelligent, studious, scholarly kid in our history, economics, and math classes, is cool. Appositives can also be used to help combine sentences. This is choppy, and we've been learning this stuff probably since we were in even elementary school. My aunt is a doctor. She is caring. She works at an evangelical hospital. What I need to do is get rid of the subject she and the other subject she in these two choppy sentences and combine using the strategy. This is just one way to combine, by the way, but using the strategy of an appositive. My aunt, a doctor, works at evangelical hospital. What kind of a doctor? A caring doctor. So this really becomes the appositive phrase offset by commas. My aunt, a caring doctor, works at evangelical hospital. And one more. The Green Bay Packers won the Super Bowl. They are Mr. Southerton's favorite team.
As they should be, Mr. Southerton. As they should be. That's why you're one good guy.
Thanks, Captain Cheesehead. Winning. Winning isn't everything. Winning is the only thing. The Green Bay Packers won the Super Bowl. They are Mr. Southerton's favorite team. Let's get rid of they are and combine by adding this information in the middle. The Green Bay Packers, Mr. Southerton's favorite team, team being the appositive, Mr. Southerton's favorite team being the appositive phrase, won the Super Bowl. Again, one would be your verb in this case. Packers would be the subject. Super Bowl is the direct object. And this information added in the middle is an appositive phrase. The Green Bay Packers, Mr. Southerton's favorite team, won the Super Bowl. Boys and girls, there is your information about the appositive and the appositive phrase. Make sure that you study up on this. It is very important. It's an essential part of writing. And I hope that you boys and girls Try to incorporate this strategy into your own writing, possibly to combine sentences just like we saw with problems 13 and 14. Mr. Southerton, over and out.
Captain Cheesehead, over and out.
Coach Lombardi, over and out.